You're listening to the Undisputed Wrestling Show on AngryMarks.com, featuring Q-Ball Carmichael, Zane Paisley, Drew Skills, and the Morning Star, William Huckabee.
The Undisputed Wrestling Show is now.
What's up, everybody? It is another Tuesday, 9 o'clock Eastern Time, and we are here snapping necks and gassing checks. The Undisputed Wrestling Show is back. I got my co-host back. He's been gone for a week. The bearded wonder, Zane Paisley, is here with me tonight. Zane, how you doing, baby?
I'm doing well. It's actually been 2 weeks. I'm rip-roaring and ready to go.
Right on. Well, I'm glad you're here, my brother. Glad that you're on here with us. We have a great show lined up. We got a great guest on the line with us, so let's get right to it. I want to introduce everybody to the main man, the Pitbull, Gary Wolf. How are you doing tonight, sir?
Awesome, brother. Thank you for having me on the show. It's great to be here. Hope all you guys had a great new year.
Happy holidays. Right on. Well, we appreciate you coming on the show. One of the things that we like to do, Gary, if it's okay with you, for our listeners who, you know, when someone's on for the first time, is kind of tell them how they got into the wrestling business and kind of break down your career for us and let us know how you got into this wacky business.
Probably my grandfather got me into it. You know, I used to watch it with him when I was a kid on Saturday mornings. And then next thing I know, I went to see one show. And next thing you know, I went to the Monster Factory. And then next thing you know, I'm playing cards with Andre the Giant in the back of WWF.
Wow.
Yeah, it blew my mind, man.
Right on. Who'd you get your training with?
Charlie Fulton was at the Monster Factory at the time. The Larry Sharp, Charlie Fulton. You know, plus I had my partner there with me at the time. He was training. We had Johnny Hotbody, Raven was there in that area at the time. You know, Bama was around. Bear, Papa Shango was there when I was there. You know, Chris Candy. A lot of guys been through the Monster Factory. It was just a matter of time, you know, like Tatanka and I think Vince Torelli was called. Ken Shamrock actually, but in North Carolina, he called him Vince Torelli. They ended up both meeting me and Anthony in North Carolina. And we worked for George Paul and Scott Jones, Paul Jones and George Scott. And we were there for a few years. And that was our first job after the Monster Factory. And that's how we got our experience.
Right on. Who was some of the people that you started working with when you broke in?
Well, honestly, we were born on old school. He found the Pit Bulls wrestling the Wild Samoans, you know what I mean? Or Terry Funk and Stan Hansen, who were doing Jersey. And most of the time when we were just coming up, we were always working the old school guys like Bob Orton, British Bulldogs, Bushwhackers, the Guerrero Brothers, which is Eddie's dad, and Rey Mysterio's father. So we got to work then, and we were in front of 55,000 in New Zealand. So, I mean, we got brought up by the old, like, we were on tour with me and Anthony Pitbulls versus Jimmy Snuka and Brutus Beefcake. That was a great tour, you know what I mean? Because we learned, you know, this is how you work, you know, old school style. It's different. It was a different time than it is now, put it that way.
Right on. What, you talk about it being a different time. What are I don't know, are you familiar with the current product, Jay?
You have to say that again.
Are you familiar with the current product?
Well, first of all, I don't see any selling. they're using finishing moves and they don't even sell. They don't even cover a guy. They just get up. That's one problem. I got a list, dude. I mean, if you really want me to tell some shit, you want to hear it, just ask, tell me straight up. I got promoters that are assholes. I mean, I used to bitch about the Bullocks, okay, because they would get money in advance. Well, now I know why they get money in advance, because these cocksucker fucking promoters cancel their shows all the time. You know, I could have had a show that night, but I couldn't take it. I'm thinking of book somewhere else. I'm not a dick. I don't double book myself. But you know what I mean? Now I see what they meant. You got to get money up front. I live in Florida now. I've flown into Philadelphia to do an autograph signing. I get a text. Once I landed in Philadelphia, I got a text. Oh, I can't do the show today. Something happened, problem in the family. Understandable, you know what I mean? No big deal, you know what I mean? I was like, all right, you know, didn't want to do anything or say anything. Next thing you know, hooked me again for something else, pulled right out again. You know what I'm saying? And that's in New York City. That's in New York City at the wrestling. I'm going to plug them. The Wrestling Universe. Go buy all the shit you want to buy is there. Okay? It ain't worth crap. That's the plug for them. That's what's going on. That's what the promoters are doing. Now I understand why the boys are doing what they do. You know? As far as, well, I mean, come on. I mean, I'm not against hardcore because I've done hardcore stuff. It's just past that limit where it's now become Hollywood. I mean, come on. If I get a brother, if I tell you to break the curve, you're not going to wake up. So if I hit you with a cinder block, you're going to die. Okay? Now they're starting to insult people's intelligence. Do you see what I'm saying?
For sure. For sure.
As a wrestler, as a fan, I mean, I'll be honest with you. I'm like, wait, am I watching a movie here? Or did this guy just get hit with a cinder block and he's still alive? You know, I don't even see any fucking color. You know? Yeah.
It's really interesting when you get guys on and, you know, to hear, you know, the differences between when they broke in and how it is now. So of course, you know, it's nice to hear your opinion. How do you really feel about it?
Hey, listen, when I broke in and while I was in, when I was in ECW and I didn't have to work for Vince or WCW at the time. I worked in Japan. So I'd fly back and forth and I'd work for ECW gave me a deal which let me go to Japan whenever I wanted. So it worked out perfectly. You know, believe me, I turned Vince down twice. Now I had a deal set in the WCW, but then Vince bought them out and I lost that deal because they couldn't hire anybody at that point. And I was just that week I was flying down to sign my deal, me and my partner. So I mean it's you know, shit happens, but it's like I said, I'd rather have done ECW in Japan because I had more flexibility, you know.
How did you land in ECW?
I was in ECW before it was ECW. I was in Tri-State Wrestling Alliance, me and my partner. And that ended up turning into Eastern Championship Wrestling. And then I was doing Japan, so I ended up getting hurt in Japan. So I had to get knee surgery. I got better. My partner was still in Germany at the time. He was working over there. And once I was better, his tour wasn't done yet. So I got in touch with Sandman and my boy Ty Gordon. And I said, yo, I'm ready to go. Bring me back. So they brought me back in as a singles first. So I got to work Jimmy Snuka, Don Morocco, Hawk from the Road Warriors. Which I've worked before. I mean, it's always great working against that guy. And the problem, you know. But then, eventually it turned into Extreme then, you know. And when Anthony came back, you know, I told Paul, you know, I said, my partner's coming back. You know, I don't mind wrestling singles. I have no problem doing it, but we are today. So, you know, we need to bring him in. So one night he said, bring him in. I'm going him in.
Right on. You said that you were lucky enough to wrestle all those great tag teams when you guys got started. Is there any, you know, tag team wrestling at one point in time was huge. It was always the second biggest thing next to the world title, that was spotlighted in most companies. Is there any team that you didn't get to work with that you wish you would have?
Any team?
What's that?
Any tag team you said?
Any tag team, sir.
And I never wrestled that I wish I would have.
Sure.
Probably the, like, Freebirds. I did wrestle Gory, don't get me wrong, but I didn't wrestle the whole team. Like, you know what I mean? Like, that would have been cool. I wrestled a lot of tag teams, man. You have to name some for me that I could say no, I didn't work against. Put it that way. I'm not lying, man. I swear. I'm talking from WWF to WCW, and beyond that. You know what I mean? like the Guerreros. Like I said, I worked Hase and Sasaki in Japan, world tag team champions. So, yeah, and I only had one wheel that night that blew my knee. That was my first trip. But I still worked. I had the Black Cat team, you know, I didn't care. I had to, you know what I mean? You just cut the ring off. So I was able to.
Well, you had mentioned that you worked against Snuka and Morocco and Hawk. Were there any times that you were told your opponent and you marked out that you were going to be able to work with them?
Marked out. No, by then I was in the business. Maybe when I went up to Vince to do jobs and stuff. We went up there back in the day when they were doing jobs on TV. And we went there because I was in school in 88. And we were just going to try to get some experience and see, you know, what it's like behind the scenes of a big company. You know, and how they do things. And, you know, that was the, you know, they paid us. And, you know, back then we were getting $150 a night, work or not work. But the match is maybe, what, 3 minutes, tops, 4 minutes, depending on what you're doing. You know, and you're doing the job, which is making them look good on TV. And they would sell you the big shows on the pay-per-views back then, if you remember correctly.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I went up there, but we only did that 10 times because we didn't want, and we didn't use the Pitbull name at all because at that time we had the name, but we wasn't going national TV to do jobs to everybody at Pitbull, put it that way.
Recently, Iron Mike Sharp passed away. Do you did you have any dealings with him in the Northeast?
Oh, yeah, I worked against him many times, man. He was a great guy, man. Funny motherfucker. Awesome. Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I went to the Monster Factory. His school was right around the corner, and a lot of my friends I know went to his school, and, you know, vice versa. And he would always work on Larry's shows and stuff like that, too, because he was a local guy that was in WWF, and, you know, Larry liked to bring in some WWF guys a lot, you know.
So what do you got going on now, Gary? What's going on in the life of Pitbull Gary Wolf now?
Oh, just relaxing, you know, getting in shape, always been in shape, but trying to get in better shape, you know, getting any younger. So, you know, doing seminars here and there, working shows here and there, independent. It's like I still look the same as I did in ECW. I don't look any different. You know, I may have a little gray now, but that's about it, brother. I still have my hair, motherfuckers. So. All my boys are losing their hair, man.
Well, how can our listeners follow your career so they can find out when you're doing seminars, when you're doing any signings that hopefully the promoters won't back out of after you land, that sort of thing?
I hear you, brother. Yeah, just go to Gary Wolf. I have a fan page, Pitbull One Gary Wolf, but I usually just work my page. It's called Gary Wolf. You can check out my shit on there. I got pictures, some ECW stuff that was televised. You can always get in touch with me through there. Like I said, I do personal appearances. I can work my ass off. I'm not the older guys that just want to do a run-in, boys. I just don't do 20 minutes with my eyes closed. No problem. So,
well,
that's another thing that cracks me up is like there's so many guys out there that could work their ass off, and they're sitting home because of egos and people got problems, man. You know, they got to let that shit go. Back in the day, I would have my boys call me up, like Public Enemy, for instance. They call me up, be like, "Yo, Gary, Bellet." I'm like, nothing right now, just chillax and wait for the weekend, you know, I gotta work, you know. And they're like, well, listen, I gotta get like 40 a Monday. We can't make it because we're doing something with WCW where, you know, can you go to Puerto Rico for us? Absolutely. I'm not doing nothing. Hell yeah, I'll take the job. Nobody does that no more, bro. Nobody gives a shit. Nobody cares about nobody but themselves. That's how it is now, man. It sucks. That's the way it is. The change, man, I'm telling you. I'm in that generation. I'm in that zone. I'm 48 right now. You know what I mean? I'm not with the older guys, and I'm not with the younger guys. I'm in that one middle spot. A lot of you guys out there know exactly what I'm talking about. But it changed a lot, man. Nobody cares. You know, you got guys working on shows for $25, $50. You know, I have no problem with them getting the experience. You know what I'm saying? You know what I mean? But when you see a guy walk around a locker room with a fucking belt that looks like a weightlifting belt, and he really thinks he's a champ. I mean, I don't know if somebody's got to smack some of these kids in the back of their head and say, wait a minute, dude, what are you the champ of? You understand what I'm saying? You got to need a reality check. That's a lot of problems. I mean, I know a lot of these veterans, they've seen it. I've seen it. It's very strange. I don't know what's going on, but it's like back in my day, 30, 35, that's when they start looking at you. Okay, you know, they liked me and Anthony when we were younger, but they weren't ready to throw us right in and start us out, you know, like they do now. You know, you're in the ring, you're a mature adult, you're not a child still. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sure. Well, Gary, we really appreciate it. We know we're short on time with you tonight, and we really appreciate you coming on and spending some time and telling your story and shooting it straight with us. We appreciate it.
No problem, man. I have no problem coming on anytime you guys really want me to come back, brother. I have no problem with it.
Yeah, we'll have to get you on when Cue Ball's available, and you guys can talk about some of the crazy times that you've had together.
Oh, yeah, man. He's cool as hell, man. And he just opened up a school. Just a lot of people know that. So
Evolution.
Check it out, man. You know what I mean?
He's doing
Q-ball, he's
going
to do it right.
Yeah. All right. Well, thanks so much. Have a great evening, and we would love to have you back on again.
No problem, man. You guys have a great night, man. Thanks a lot.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Peace out.
All right, Drew. Fun show.
Pitbull
so
Gary
far.
Wolf.
What's that?
Pitbull Gary Wolf.
Pitbull Gary Wolf. Not holding anything back.
He's telling it like he believes it, brother.
Yeah. Yeah. So I heard some interesting news about an upcoming event.
What's that?
The battle of the Undisputed Hosts coming up soon in March.
It's coming. I believe it's April.
April. Sorry.
Yeah, you gotta give Will Huckabee a little bit more time to try to prepare, but I don't really think that a month is gonna be enough time for him, but it's gonna be a battle. It's gonna be fun. I'm really looking forward to it.
And what's the date on that?
I'm not exactly sure. I know it's Smash Mouth Pro Wrestling, and it's in April. I gotta look up the date here real quick, but Jeremy Seabolt, the promoter at Smash Mouth Pro Wrestling, came on, and he'd been talking to Will Huckabee, and he made it happen, man. So we're going to get it on.
That's amazing. That'll be great. And I'll be up there for that show as long as it's not April 25th, which is my wife's birthday. So hopefully it won't be that day.
It is going to be on April 23rd.
Okay. We're cutting it close, but hopefully I'll be able to get out of the house that day.
Well, hopefully you'll be able to be there. Hopefully our executive producer, Rick Craig, will be able to come up, and we'll make it a big Undisputed Wrestling Show event. And I'm really looking forward to it. Will has been doing some big things out there and doing a lot of traveling, and it's time for him to step it up to the next level. So we'll see what he's got.
Yeah. So did you have much of a chance last week to talk about your match at NWA Circle City Wrestling?
We talked about it a little bit. I was still a little beat up and sore when we recorded last week's show. So of course I let the people know that's what was going on. I was a little beat up and sore from that event. But right now, man, I'm feeling great, and I'm looking forward to making my way right back to another shot at that NWA World Heavyweight Championship.
Well, let me tell you. That got the Zane Paisley Match of the Night Award. Huge Hoss fight. You took it to the NWA World Heavyweight Champion. You had so many close calls in that match. He just got the better of you. If you're gonna lose to anybody, losing the world champion is the best person to lose to.
Yeah, you know, I've said it before, you know, and I'll say it again, man. Jack Stain is a world class performer. He is legitimately a big bad man, you know, and we went to war, and I definitely felt it. I remember Will Huckabee on here talking about when we had Jax on the call, unfortunately, I wasn't here, but he was talking about how physical. And typically, a lot of times, you know, my intensity isn't matched in the ring. But, man, Jax brought it. He definitely matched my intensity, and he was the better man on that night. But fortunately for me, there's many nights to come.
That's right. That's right. So what else you been up to, buddy?
Not a whole lot, man. You know, just doing the thing. I got a big show up in Warsaw coming this weekend for Funkified. It's been a little while since I've been there, so I'm looking forward to getting back up there. And a friend of the show is up there running around calling himself a champion. So I got to go up there and see what I can do about that old Congo Kong.
Oh, man. That's pretty insane.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, he's a big guy. I just saw a match that he did. I saw a finish to a match that he did either last weekend or the weekend before, where it was him and Hillbilly Jed teaming up to take on Jacob Johns, who's another big guy. Not as big as those two, but he's a big guy. And a youngster that probably weighs about less than 200 pounds named Cole Radrick. And they did a double team maneuver to finish the match onto Radrick, where Congo splashed him, and then Hillbilly Jed did a senton bomb. So that was pretty crazy into a match.
Wow, did Radrick get stretchered out?
I did not say, it was not on the tape, and I haven't talked to him yet, so I'll check with him this coming Friday.
That is a lot of weight coming down on you, brother.
Yes, yes. Sorry to interrupt. So you're going to be taking on Congo Kong soon?
Not this weekend. That's definitely what my sights are on. But I have Atlas Hightower this weekend. But he's a men's to the end. You know what I mean? I plan on going up there and making a statement. And I've already let Congo know. I don't try to sneak up behind people, man. I call them out and I come right at them.
Now, does Congo understand what you're saying? I don't know if he's got a great grasp of English. His buddy Steve Wilson knows a little bit, but I'm not sure if Congo knows much.
I'm not sure if he does or not, but if he don't, then, you know, that's not my fault.
Well, I had the opportunity to go to Ring of Honor Wrestling here in Indianapolis on Friday night. It was a fun show. I took some go ahead.
How did they draw?
You know, they had what was, I would consider, a sellout, but I think that they only had around 300 seats in the building. They could have had a lot more seats in there. So, you know, I know it was what they were expecting, because I don't think that they were selling any tickets at the door. At least you can ask Remy if they were selling any tickets at the door, but I didn't see them selling any tickets at the door. So I would say probably 300 to 350.
Right on. That's definitely better than the last time they've been in Indianapolis.
Oh, really? But that's been quite a few years ago. That was about 6 years ago, I think.
It's been a while, so I was hoping that they did well when they came, so that they would come back.
Yeah. No, it seemed like they were having a good time. The Prophet Rick Craig was there with his son Colin. Bunch of my Beards and Zubaz brothers were there, and we had a good time. Got to take some Mark photos with the Young Bucks and with Cheeseburger and Moose and Dalton Castle and ACH. So it was a good time. We had a lot of fun.
Yeah, I saw some of those pictures. It looked like you guys were having a good time there.
Yeah, and Dalton Castle was talking to his buddy from Chikara, Ashley Remington, Smooth Sailing Ashley Remington. He recognized me from Beards and Zubaz, so that was fun. That was cool. So hopefully we'll get Dalton Castle on the show soon.
Right on. We gotta get the Beard and Zubaz crew out to CCW.
Yeah. I'm definitely for that. So yeah, if any time was right, it was when the last two shows when the Animal was there. But our buddy Rich Abbott, who's going to be on here in a few minutes, he was representing at the last show, so that was real good. So
right on. Yeah, I believe Animal. You know, there's talks of Animal coming back. I don't think that was his last his last hurrah with us there. So I believe he's going to come back. And then we got a big show on Valentine's Day, February 14th. Jazz will be there. Rodney Mack will be there. Of course, Billy Gunn and Kevin Thorne were at the last show setting up their match for this show. Those guys are going to be there. So another big show coming for NWA CCW here in Indianapolis.
Yeah, they put on amazing shows, and you are definitely one of the biggest stars there. Always put on a great match. They got that that young kid, Jonathan Lone Wolf. His match, it was a four-way match with him and Trevor Court and Dale Patricks and Ace Perry. And they were one of the show stealers. Not as great as the championship match that you were in, but it was another great match that they put on. So,
yeah, those kids are hungry, man, and you know they really cause for the locker room to step up, because those guys are going to go out there and definitely leave it all in the ring. So, you know, it's a good motivator for us guys going on weight to make sure that we don't phone it in.
So, as I mentioned with Pitbull Gary Wolf on, Iron Mike Sharp had passed away recently. And, I don't know what the proper term is, enhancement talent, pro wrestler, jobber, job guy, carpenter, whatever you want to call him. He was one of the great guys that made the stars look like mega stars. If it weren't for guys like Iron Mike Sharp, there would be no Ultimate Warrior. There would be no Hulk Hogan. There would be no one like that. And he was one of the more memorable men because he always wore the forearm cover because his forearm was constantly hurt. So hopefully wherever he is now, his arm is healed. Do you have any great memories of Iron Mike Sharp?
Like you said before, man, or like you just mentioned, Iron Mike Sharp was one of those guys who you always remembered. You know, he may not have been, I don't recall ever seeing him win a match, but I remember him very vividly. So, you know, that time period that he came in was very pivotal in wrestling. It's kind of a lost art on television wrestling nowadays as far as enhancement talent or like you said, you know, there's several different terms for it. But coming on television and putting a guy over, that's you know, now with 50-50 booking and such and on the big show, it's, you know, you don't see those guys do those things that much anymore. Occasionally you'll have a local guy show up on television and you know, it's more of a 2-minute thing for a monster versus a guy that could go in there and have a competitive match, but put the guy over and really make the guy look strong, and he was great at doing that.
Yes, yes. Okay. On the line with us, our next guest is from Wrestling Theology Fellowship, or subtitled WTF. It is big-time wrestling fan, great guy, Rich Rabbit Abbott. How are you tonight, Rich?
I'm doing great, Zane.
Awesome. As I said, Drew Skills is on with us as well. We're going to ask you a couple quick questions, and then we'll get into some of your what's going on with WTF. So, Rich, I know a lot about you, but I want our listeners to know. How did you get into this crazy business of pro wrestling? And we'll talk about WTF after you talk about how you got interested in wrestling.
Well, you know, I've grown up watching it since I was 2 years old. Been big wrestling fan. My dad actually took me to Hulk Hogan versus Andre the Giant here in Indianapolis. I was sitting on his shoulders. Ever since then, I've been big time wrestling fan.
Well, you got to set it up a little bit better than that. It wasn't just Hulk Hogan versus Andre the Giant. It was the Friday night main event where they had the double referees.
Yeah, they did. I actually thought as a child, you know, I bought into the whole twin referee, or not twin, but plastic surgery. $1 Million Man, bought the referee off. plastic surgery on one of the Hebners, off of Dave Hebner. And I bought in hook, line, and sinker on that. I mean, I couldn't believe that somebody would ruin their whole life just to look like another person.
Well, so tell our listeners what WTF Wrestling Theology Fellowship is all about.
Well, basically, Wrestling Theology Fellowship is a community of wrestling fans. We're getting this started here in Indianapolis. That's what I'd like to, bill it as first and foremost. It's the community of fans. We have a purpose. We are a Christian-based organization, and each one of our events are hopefully going to be having some sort of charity involved as well. So we're doing not necessarily wrestling shows to start off with, but we're going to be hosting some live pay-per-view viewing parties at Fox and Hound in Castleton. And our first show, we're doing a soft launch of Wrestling Theology viewing parties with the Royal Rumble this Sunday.
Well, so before we get into that, tell us what made you, what inspired you to do Wrestling Theology Fellowship?
Well, that kind of goes into, I found faith a few years ago. I was kind of struggling, with my life, found God, and there's something called pub theology, which wrestling theology is a bit of an offshoot of that. And, some of you may know if you're in the Indianapolis area, Darren Earlywine is the pub pastor that is on the Smiley Morning Show. And, we go out and do bar events, put on Christian events and, bars, and do giveaways and have a big party basically every month. And about, I would say, a year and a half ago, maybe a little more, had some of the guys from the Pub Theology crew kind of corner me, and they knew I was going to these wrestling conventions and hanging out with wrestling fans all the time, and they said that I should share Christ through wrestling. And I said, I don't know how that's actually works. So I've been figuring that out for the last couple years, trying to figure out how to make that work, and I think I've got something going in the right track now.
Okay, so tell us about your first event that you're doing for Royal Rumble. Where is it, and what should the person that attends it expect from it?
Well, the first event, like I said, it's a soft launch, so we're not going to have a special guest at that event. We're kind of there, kind of hosting it. I believe, I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure Fox and Hound is letting people come in for free. There's no cover charge for the Royal Rumble event. I believe that is the deal that we have with them. So people can come in and they can just watch the Royal Rumble free of charge, as they used to. I know that the Fox and Hound used to hold all the pay-per-view events, but we're going to host it this time. And we're going to be doing some giveaways. We're probably going to be talking, doing the giveaways and such between matches or in the pre-show. We're going to try not to interrupt the actual show itself.
Okay, so then tell our listeners what you've got planned. You said that this is the soft launch. Tell our listeners what you have planned for the next WWE pay-per-view, Fastlane.
All right, so for the Fastlane pay-per-view, that is February 21st. Mark your calendars, folks, because we're going to have Lex Luger and Nikita Koloff come and join us. A couple hours before the pay-per-view, that'll be the Fastlane pay-per-view at Fox and Hound. Now, the event will be starting at 5 o'clock. Seating will be open at 4:30. Tickets are $35 for an adult, $25 for kids under 10. But what's included with that ticket is you get a free autograph and picture with Lex and Nikita. And I believe there's chips and salsa, and you're also pre-seated for the pay-per-view event that will be going on after the show. So from 5 to 7, Lex and Nikita will tell some wrestling stories. They'll take some questions from the audience, do a Q&A. They'll also share their faith, because like I said, this is a Christian deal here. But then there will also be time for the meet and greet. And then they will stay for most of the pay-per-view. They have the option to stay till the end. I know that it's a long day for them because we've got them doing some other things. Because we will also be doing a live webinar for anybody out there that is not in the Indianapolis area but still wants to have an interaction with Lex or Nikita. We'll be doing that at like 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and then at 5 o'clock they'll do their show there, and then they'll stay at least halfway through the pay-per-view.
So people who show up to the Fox and Hound will be able to meet with Lex Luger and Nikita Koloff, who are two of my favorites of all time, get to interact with them, get a photo opportunity, and get to listen to them talk about their faith and their wrestling careers. Sounds like a great deal to me.
Yep, you are exactly right. Plus, don't forget the chips and salsa.
Plus chips and salsa. How could you forget about that?
Zane, how could you forget about chips and salsa?
I'm so sorry, Drew. That should have been the first thing off the top of my mind. So, Drew, do you have any questions about Wrestling Theology Fellowship?
I tell you, sounds like a good thing, man. Sounds really cool. I hope it does really well. I tell you, I don't usually do pay-per-views, like pay-per-view parties or whatnot, but I have been pre-network. I was pre-WWE Network. I had went to Fox and Hound on two different occasions. And, man, they packed that place, and those guys get rowdy like, as if they were at the arena. So that's a great place to have it, and hopefully you guys have a great turnout. And like I said, man, those guys, I don't know how it is now since the Network, but I was there. Like I said, I went there twice, and, I mean, those guys get in with a chance, and, you know, they really go nuts.
Yeah, we are excited about being there. And, of course, but, you know, one thing, at all of our events, we are going to be doing some giveaways, too. So, you know, you guys can get any autographs, DVDs, and some other winning items there as well. So
Rich, tell us about some of your sponsors that you've got for WTF.
Well, one of the sponsors that we have is Beards and or not Beards and Zubas, just Zubas. Zubas is a sponsor. They are a pant company. If you're not aware of it, I don't know why you're listening to this podcast. they're going to be supplying us with some products for our February event. We'll not have any products January event, the Rumble, unfortunately for that event, but they will find some product to give away stuff for that. We also have Sport Clips as a sponsorship. They're the ones up. They've got three different stores, and those stores are in, let me make sure I tell you correctly. There's the one on 96th Street, there's the one on Stone, and then there's the one up here in Fishers off the 13th at the Target. So those three sports are sponsoring us as well. And then we also have a deal in the Wrestle Crate. So if you're not aware of Wrestle Crate, they are a crate-based company where you can get box of random wrestling items, and it's a pretty, you get some pretty cool stuff in it.
Awesome, brother. So, How can our listeners get tickets to the February event? Because the one next weekend, the Royal Rumble, is free. The event in February where you're going to have special guests Nikita Koloff and Lex Luger, there is a fee involved. $35 for adults, $25 for kids. How can they get these tickets?
So those tickets are going to be available. Now, they're not released yet. They will be available at WrestlingBOTicket.com. Right now, that website is not going to take you anywhere, but when the tickets go on sale, it will take you to those to that site. Tickets will also be available to be purchased at the Royal Rumble event. So we will be selling them live at the event this Sunday, and we hope to have the tickets up and running the website this week. We're just having some issues with the web guy, but just issues getting a hold of them this week. So, but that should all be up and running very, very soon, and there will be an announcement on our Facebook page, which is let's see, Wrestling Theology, WTF.
Rich, you still there?
Yes.
Okay. It's facebook.com/WTF Wrestling Theology.
Yes, I was trying to look that up to make sure I was correct on that.
Yeah. Or if you just type in WTF Wrestling Theology, it'll pop up.
All right. Very good. But that's how we'll have the tickets released, is if you go to that website, or if you go to our Facebook will be pushing that and letting you know where to get tickets. And I'm sure we're going to be telling people over and over again the next month or so how to get your tickets. So
you said that Fastlane is going to be your first big event with guests in, and that's got Nikita Koloff and Lex Luger. You want to, the next pay-per-view after that is WrestleMania. You want to give our listeners any hints about who you're bringing in for WrestleMania?
Well, since you mentioned it, I was going to ask you, do you want a bombshell? Do you want something dropped on the, cause I'm ready to give it out if you want me to break this news on your podcast.
Drew, do you like exclusives?
This is where the exclusives happen, baby. This is where it all goes down. This is where Dan Severn broke the news that he will fight Ken Shamrock again. This is where we found out about the big, huge Drew Skills versus Will Huckabee. Lay it on us, baby. What's happening WrestleMania weekend here in Indianapolis? What do you got going on? Tell us.
Well, this year, Indianapolis, Fox and Hound, WrestleMania, we've got a pretty big guest lined up here. And it's funny that you mentioned Ken Shamrock and Dan Severn, because our guest will be actually the world's most dangerous man, Ken Shamrock.
Awesome. Right on, Ken Shamrock.
Yeah. He will be the guest for our WrestleMania event. We don't have the time specified yet, because basically we don't know how long WrestleMania is this year. Yeah, we haven't been told yet if it's 6 hours or 8 hours or however long to go, but when we figure out the timing on that, then we'll be able to space out when we have our event.
So you're bringing in former U.S. champion, former world champion Lex Luger, former U.S. champion Nikita Koloff, and I'm sure that those guys have had tag team title reigns also for Fastlane. Mm-hmm. And then for WrestleMania, you're bringing in UFC Hall of Famer, UFC champion, and former WWF Intercontinental Champion, Tag Team Champion, King of the Ring, and even an NWA World Heavyweight Champion, Ken Shamrock, to Indianapolis.
Yes, I am. You've got all that right.
Well, that is phenomenal, Rich. Give us the plugs for the social media again, then.
Okay, that was facebook.com/WTF Wrestling Theology. I got that right this time, right?
I think so. Did you set up an Instagram and a Twitter and all that, too?
We just set up a Twitter I believe that is, let's see here. I should have had all this ready for you.
That's all right. We called you a little early.
Let's see. I believe it is just Wrestling Geology.
Okay.
On Twitter. And then of course, the tickets will be available at WrestlingTheoTicket.com. That's wrestling and T-H-E-O, shortened theology there, tickets.com.
Awesome, Rich. Do you have time to stick around and make some Royal Rumble predictions with us?
Yeah, I can do that if you guys want me to. I can.
I wouldn't have invited you if we didn't want you to.
Yeah.
but you got to remember, Mr. Skills is right on most of these, so.
All right, yeah.
Hey.
Well, maybe he'll go first, and I can follow.
Hey.
But one more question before we move on. You kind of skimmed by it a little bit. You said, as of right now, you're not planning shows. Is the plan to eventually run wrestling shows, or is it just to use these pay-per-view events that are bringing people together?
Well, you know, the idea is that eventually we do run some shows. And I've been in talks with a local promotion to, possibly work together on that. Whereas, you know, we would be kind of partnering with another promotion to bring, stuff together on that front. So, we're in talks with that stuff, and, we've got some pretty cool venues as well, that I think fans would really enjoy, checking out wrestling at. So I'm excited about that as well, but I don't want to get too far into it because I don't want to, release all that too early. But yeah, we do have some plans in the future for that to possibly happen.
And I'm sure as soon as you get those plans worked out, you're going to be inviting Mr. Skills to participate, correct?
Oh, I mean, yeah. we're definitely looking for the best of the best here in Indianapolis. And the surrounding areas to be part of these shows that we put on.
Well, you're talking to him right now. Not me, of course. But
Well, thank you, Zane. But I do know some people, so when you get ready, you talk to Zane if he knows how to contact some people.
All righty.
Rich has been working on this for a while. He's been in contact with good people that you know. So, you know, one of the things I like about WTF Wrestling Theology Fellowship, it's definitely a faith-based organization that you put together there, Rich, but it doesn't take itself too seriously. You know, hence the name WTF. What do you think about when you say that? Well, now you think about Wrestling Theology Fellowship. You know, it's about having fun. It's about camaraderie and it's about putting your faith out there. So It's not all leaning one way or leaning another way. It's a good mix. Wouldn't you say that's right, Rich?
Oh, yeah. I mean, our core group of people that we've been meeting together, we've been watching pay-per-views just at my house, and just kind of brainstorming how we can get this thing going. I would say it's a 50-50 on how many people are actually Christians, part of this Christian group, which is a really cool deal. If you ask me, because, I mean, you got a good mix of people and we're all going towards a good cause. And, you know, like I said, we're going to try to have a charity at each event as well to try to bring, some charity sponsorships, some charity, charity offering, where you're not obligated to give, but there will be a charity there and, you know, we'll just kind of take it and put it out there and say, hey, this is what we got going on this month. If you are able to give any more to that, then, you know, bless you guys.
Yeah, and, you know, so at your events, and we'll get to the Rumble predictions here in just a moment once Mr. Morningstar Will Huckabee joins us. But at your events, you know, I would say that if you're a wrestling fan, come show up. If you've got faith and you want to talk about that, and you also want to enjoy some wrestling, even if you're not a huge wrestling fan, you know, come and show up. Obviously, if you're listening to this show, you're a huge wrestling fan. But if you've got friends that want to go out and have a good time, have a couple beers, play a little pool, watch some wrestling at Fox and Hound. Come on out, check out this event. So,
yeah, and this would be the best time to do it this Sunday because it's not. This one's going to be a free event. So,
yeah, it's a good thing to check out. So, all right, do we have Mr. Morningstar on yet? I'm going to take that as a no. He'll be calling in any minute now. So let me just set this up. Royal Rumble coming this weekend, this Sunday night. Obviously, I'm going to be at a... okay, Kev, are you on the line? Kill Kev?
Yeah, I think he must have stepped away because Will's trying to get in.
Yeah, that's what I was just going to say. All right, so we'll go ahead and start... start with some Royal Rumble predictions, but we'll save the big stuff for when Will comes on. So the first match I want to talk about then is the Divas Championship. It's Charlotte with her father, Ric Flair, who's the champion, versus Becky Lynch. I think Kevin's going to be getting Will on here in just a moment. Will, you on with us, buddy?
Hang on just a second. I'm getting them punched uphill.
Okay, cool.
William Huckabee.
Hey, what's going on, man? You trying to go with my radio or what? You trying to kind of fuzzy right now?
Joining us on the line at this time is Megatron.
All right.
Yeah, you sound exactly like Megatron right now.
Yeah, can you call us back, Will?
Yeah, I'll call you guys right back, guys.
Awesome.
Zane, you didn't tell me I was going to be on here with Bane.
Yeah. or maybe that was a special guest appearance by Shockmaster.
Yes.
Our Uncle Fred called us tonight. Drew, did you get a chance to talk to Fred Ottman much when he was at the Heroes and Legends event?
I talked to him a little bit. I didn't get to talk to him that much. Unfortunately, those events are pretty hectic for me. But I did get a chance to talk to him. He's an awesome guy.
I had a chance to talk with him for a few minutes of that event, and then I went down to Florida to visit my mother last June, and he was just at a wrestling show that I went to down there, and I had a chance to talk with him for a while. Super nice guy. Love interacting with him on social media, so it's a nice shout out from Will Huckabee to portray Shockmaster for us tonight.
Really? Really? That hurts, guys.
Aw, what's up, Morningstar? How are you?
I'm all right, man. I think it has something to do with somebody being afraid of, you know, me coming to Indiana in April. That's why I know all of a sudden my mic is sabotaged.
That is pretty crazy.
I don't know why Will would be, or why Zane would be worried about you coming. Will, I think he's excited.
I am excited, but I'm worried that you're going to want to stay on my couch or something.
No, of course not. You know, guys like me from Carolina, we only travel in style, man.
Hey, Will, we've got my friend Rich Abbott from Wrestling Theology Fellowship on with us right now. He's going to help us make some Rumble predictions. But before we do that, how's it been going? I haven't talked with you in weeks.
I know, man. It's actually going really well. The last couple of weeks have kind of been slow for me or whatever. Just taking time to heal up and get everything straight in my life. But, you know, starting this weekend, man, back on the road, you know, 3 days a week and stuff and getting things done.
Well, that's awesome. So so you've postponed your trip to Indiana for a couple months so you can get in better shape, get better cardio, get ripped a little bit more for your epic battle with Drew Skills. Is that correct?
Of course, man. You know what I'm saying? Like, I forgot all about the fact that you weren't even on last week when we announced it, when that match got announced, were you, Zane?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm very excited for it. That's awesome.
You know, what's so funny about that whole thing being announced and stuff was, you know, hearing about Drew being afraid of who he was going to have to wrestle that night and stuff and, you know, being all butt hurt, et cetera, et cetera. It was actually pretty funny to me.
Uh-huh, I'm sure. Do you have any response to that, Drew?
No.
He's no-selling you.
I get it. Look, he can no-sell me now, you know, while we're on the radio and stuff, while we're on the show, but when he sees me face-to-face, guaranteed there will be no-selling. You know, he's already been warned. He's already been warned by, you know, Damian Wayne and QR Carmichael, you know, that when it comes down to it comes down to pounding somebody and stuff and bringing the pain, you know. I do it with the best. I can put a beat down to anybody.
Yeah. Hey, Will, I was thinking about you a couple weeks ago. I saw an ex-girlfriend of yours.
Oh, really, Zane?
I saw Connie.
Really? I know, man. It feels like I was telling the guys last week, and it's kind of funny, you know, now I'm packing my beer bag and stuff, and I'm throwing it in the car, and for some reason, it just feels super light. And I'm like, you know, am I forgetting something? And they're like, oh, yeah, I don't have a title anymore. I'm like, oh. But at the same time, you know, it's kind of a it's okay. You know, Brad was a great champion. He's a fighting champion just like I was and stuff. And I've said it before, and I'll say it again, you know, I lost, but he himself didn't beat me. So I have a rematch coming and stuff. I'm just taking my time, trying to decide what's the proper time to go ahead and cash that in.
Okay. All right, I can't wait to hear about that. You've been doing a lot of stuff with AWE recently?
Oh, yeah. They just had their one show. They just had their January show and stuff, and I was on the clock for that. I was actually in West Virginia actually protecting the business, if you may. I had a match, a tag team match, against two local celebrity MMA fighters in Beckley, West Virginia. I had to put the boots on those guys and stuff. You know, we're back in AWE, back in Atlanta, February 21st. It's probably one of the craziest matches ever. Us, Team IOU, us versus Team IOU versus Chip Day and Murder One.
Sounds amazing. Is that the show that Indiana favorite Trip Cassidy is going to be on?
Yeah, he actually is. Now, I'm actually super excited because I've never my buddy Joe told me so much about Trip Cassidy. But me, myself, personally, I've never seen him live, so I'm really super excited to see what all the hype is about. So I know, like, Owen Knight is a really good stuff, and he's really coming into his own. He's a really, really good young up-and-coming wrestler and stuff, so I'm really excited to see what him and Chip are going to do.
Okay. All right, anything else we need to discuss before we get into the Royal Rumble predictions, guys? Okay. Silence means that we're... Okay. All right, first match that we'll talk about, Charlotte, who is the Divas champion with her father, Ric Flair, at ringside versus Becky Lynch. Drew Skills, who you got in this match?
Charlotte.
Why do you say that?
It's just not time yet. They're gonna continue it. Charlotte's going to be wearing that title going into WrestleMania. And my hopes is that it will be her and Sasha, or her, Sasha, and Becky in a three-way.
Oh, okay. I get you there. What about you, Rich Abbott? What do you think about that match?
Well, Becky is my girl. but I will say, you know, what I think is going to happen, I think they'll have, I think Charlotte's going to come out due to some outside interference as the winner, or at least still as champion. I think that'll lead to a second match with Becky. And on my personal hopes is there's going to be either a triple threat or a four-way with, like, Paige and Sasha involved at WrestleMania.
Hey, what about you, Will Huckabee? What do you think about the Divas Championship match?
Yeah, I'm going to go ahead and, as much as I hate to agree with him right now, I'm going to go ahead and agree with Drew. It's just not the correct time to pull the plug yet on the whole Charlotte and Flair thing going on. So I think they're going to continue. I think she's going to come out on top of this, and they're going to keep on with the storyline straight into WrestleMania. I think her versus Sasha is more of a – I think that they should set that up for WrestleMania. I think that's more of a WrestleMania-style match. And her and Becky, you know, it's cool. I think they're going to use this more as a setup for that match for WrestleMania.
I have to agree. I hope Charlotte's, I hope Sasha is better by WrestleMania. She's injured right now. But I don't see a reason to take the belt off Charlotte right now. Tag team championship match. The tag team champions, the New Day, versus the Usos. Rich, who do you got in that match?
I have the best tag team of 2015, the New Day.
They weren't the Slammy Award winners for 2015 Best Tag Team.
They were not even a tag team that year until November.
Okay. So you got New Day going over.
I have New Day. I think that Xavier is going to come out with something, either like a huge trombone or something to...
A phone.
What's that?
Maybe a sousaphone.
Okay, yeah. Something. he's got to top the trombone, especially since they did the funeral for it.
Okay. All right, Will, who do you have in that match?
Of course, you know, I got the New Day, man. My favorite thing is not named Paul Heyman wrestling now in WWE. So I'm definitely, you know, going for those guys.
Drew, who do you have in that match? Drew Skills, who do you have winning the tag team championship match?
My bad, I had some technical difficulties with my mic. But I got New Day. My only worry is that because they're over with or without the titles, that they may pull them, but I'd like keep it with the New Day.
Okay. Yeah, I don't see a reason to take the belts off. Usos came back and had a little bit of a push, but I don't see them, you know, making that much of an impact right now. I'm going to say keep it on New Day. So far we've got two heels winning. It's weird. This whole pay-per-view is only championship matches. So that's kind of interesting. Next one we'll talk about the United States Championship, champion Alberto Del Rio versus the former champion for a day, Kalisto. Will, who do you got in this match?
I'm going to say the key to Alberto Del Rio. I'm not saying that Kalisto is not a great champion, but I look at him more as a Rey Mysterio kind of guy. He's going to always be a perpetual underdog. He's always going to get over chasing the title. Once he gets the title, he will never be as over as he is when he's chasing it. So for that reason and that reason alone, they're going to keep it on Alberto Del Rio.
Okay, what do you think, Drew Skills?
AER, Alberto Del Rio wins this one. The only reason Kalisto's in this match is because of Cena's injury.
Okay. All right. What about you, Rich?
I think Kalisto takes the United States Championship back. I think they're going to keep playing a little bit of hot potato with that and keep things a little more unplanned, make you feel like unpredictability can happen with that match, with that belt.
Okay. I'm still confused why they put it on him in the first place, just take it off of him a day later. I think that it would have built much more if they would have kept it on him for, you know, 2 weeks. so that way ADR got his rematch at the pay-per-view. I'm going to say ADR walks away with it. I think that they need to still keep the League of Nations stable, somewhat strong, and he'd be the only one that can be able to do that right now. So, next match, WWE Intercontinental Championship, Dean Ambrose, the champion, versus former champion Kevin Owens. Drew Skills, what do you think about John Moxley and Kevin Steen?
I'm going with my boy Mox, man. Dean Ambrose on that one.
Awesome. What's your reasoning behind that?
Because I don't want to see Steen win the belt.
Okay. All right. Rich Abbott, what do you think about that?
I like last man standing matches. Some people don't because they think
thank you. I didn't even mention that it was a last man standing match. Thank you for
that. Oh, yes. I enjoy last man standing matches because usually they got some pretty cool spots in the match. A lot of people don't like the counting aspect, but my personal opinion, I like those matches. I'm excited to see the match. I'm a fan of both. I think Ambrose wins the match only because I think Owens is going to go on maybe a little further up the card. I could be wrong.
Will Huckabee, what are your thoughts on this match?
Well, first of all, this is the match that I want to see more than any other match. You know, usually with last man standing matches, you see the obligatory tables, chairs, and ladder spots and stuff, and you always see you know the music of stairs. But these two guys can really brawl. They really made their bones in the Indies brawling and stuff, and they're known as great brawlers. So I'm really looking forward to seeing all the creative things that they're able to do with each other in this match. Unlike Drew, I really want to see Kevin Owens get over. I think that he's done a great job being the Intercontinental Champion, just as much as when he was the NXT Champion. I think that he has elevated that championship to prominence. Not saying that any other former wrestler hasn't, but I think that he really, him holding the title really makes that title important.
for some reason. So for that reason, I'm gonna say Owens over.
Okay, I'm just picking all heels tonight. I'm gonna say it stays with Dean Ambrose. I like Rich's thought about Owens hopefully being moved up the card a little bit, not fighting for a secondary title. I think it's gonna be the best out of all the preliminary matches before the main event. So, but I'm gonna say Dean Ambrose, and I hope that they do a decisive finish, not something stupid, but it is a last man standing match, so who knows? Maybe they'll beat an exploding television screen or something like that. So I don't know. All right, main event time. This is the all versus one 30-man Royal Rumble match for the WWE World Heavyweight Championship. 24 years ago today, Ric Flair won the WWF Championship.
Woo!
At the Royal Rumble. This time there is a champion going into it, starting off at number one, Roman Reigns. And I'm not sure if the stip is whoever throws out Roman Reigns becomes champion, or if it's the final winner that wins the championship. Does anybody have any clarity on that?
I believe it's the final winner, but I don't really, I'm not Vince, so.
Okay.
I'm a little confused on that too, because not yesterday, but 2 weeks or last week, Vince had mentioned whoever throws him out becomes the champion. So I don't know exactly how that works either.
Well, I got to assume that Roman Reigns is going to be one of the final two participants in there. So we might just be talking about nothing. But anyway, the Roman Reigns will be in there having to defend his WWE World Heavyweight Championship versus 29 other men. I want to hear who you guys think will be some surprise entrants in there, because every year there's a surprise entry or two. So, you know, you guys can do these on educated guesses, or you can throw something wild out there. What you think the finish is going to be. So I think we're back around to Rich. So Rich, what are your thoughts on the Royal Rumble match?
Well, my first question is, do we have an official list of participants?
From what I'm seeing right now, the only list that I see is Big Show, Curtis Axel, Bray Wyatt, Braun Strowman, Luke Harper, Eric Rowan, Ryback, Dolph Ziggler, Jericho, Reigns, of course, Brock Lesnar, Stardust, Sheamus, R-Truth, Neville, Titus O'Neil. I'm also going to assume that Bo Dallas and Adam Rose and Heath Slater, I think, were also mentioned in it, but we don't have a complete list because they always want to have some surprises in there.
Okay. I don't know what they're going to do. If I was booking this, if I was the one that was doing this match here, I would have Triple H as a surprise and have him eliminate Roman. And then have somebody different win the championship and take Reigns into a feud with Triple H. I think it would be a time to freshen up the Royal Rumble and the championship there. I think, you know, you got people in there like a Bray Wyatt who hasn't really had a chance to get himself out there a lot in the main event. He's wrestled some matches, but I don't feel like he's been given really a fair shake, my personal opinion, anyway.
What's your official prediction?
My official prediction is kind of up in the air. I'll go with Bray Wyatt just because I think that would be really cool. See something like out of left field and make everything go into a different direction with Reigns being eliminated by Triple H. And I think you'll see guys, some of the guys that, like a Road Dog, maybe. I'd like to personally see some guys like Tonka, Road Warrior Animal, some guys like that come in as a surprise.
Okay. All right. Will Huckabee, what are your thoughts?
Are you asking me anything?
Yes, sir.
right. I'm thinking, first of all, I don't like the concept of the champion being in the Royal Rumble match. I just don't like that. I think that he should have a match during the pay-per-view, and then he automatically knows, you know, the winner of the match should be the guy facing him in WrestleMania. I don't like the idea of whoever throws him out being the champion, and then whoever wins goes to WrestleMania as the number one contender. I don't like the entire concept. With that being said, as far as surprises go, you know, we've all heard the rumors, if you've been on Facebook and stuff, about supposedly AJ Styles might be making an appearance into the Royal Rumble. I don't know so much if I would like to see him make his debut at the Royal Rumble. It would definitely be a surprise for them to sign him and then immediately put him in the Royal Rumble. I think that would be a shock for everybody. I actually think this is going to be the Royal Rumble where we see a lot of the NXT guys coming up. I would like to see Apollo Crews come up. I would like to see Baron Corbin come up. I would like to see Bull Dempsey in the Royal Rumble. That's just my thought. I think that this will be the, as great as NXT is going, as much as it's on a roll right now, I think that this will be the perfect Royal Rumble to introduce a lot of the NXT guys to the main roster. I think that the winner, actually, I think the surprise is going to be, Seth Rollins is going to pull the John Cena and come back months earlier than anybody expected. Huh?
That would be awesome.
I think that he's going to pull the John Cena. He's going to be entrant number 30, and is going to pull a rated R superstar and knock out, you know, or throw out Roman Reigns, become the champion, and they're going to set up Seth Rollins versus Brock Lesnar for the WrestleMania main event.
Okay. Drew Skills, what are your thoughts on the Rumble?
Well, I hate to agree with Will, but I absolutely, absolutely hate this concept. The champion should not be in the Royal Rumble, and I think it's even worse with Roman. If you remember, Roman was booed, last year because of, Daniel Bryan not being in. I think they've done too much with Bullet Club, the Balor Club, and AJ Styles and Finn Balor. If they don't show up, if one of those guys don't show up, they're going to be upset with it. And if they do show up and get eliminated, they're going to be upset with it. I do think Roman's going to, he's going to be the big babyface champion that makes through it all. And I think that they're setting it up to where it's not going to be in his favor. in his favor for doing that. I think he's going to end up. It's going to backfire on them when either they don't show up or when they do and get eliminated, people are going to be pissed about it. So I don't like that at all. I do agree that some of the NXT guys probably will be in the Rumble match itself, but I don't think that will be their debut on the roster. I think it'll be a one-off. They'll show up, they'll get eliminated, and they'll go back to NXT.
Okay, so who's your choice for the winner?
Roman Reigns.
Okay. All right. They have a lot of opportunities to make this really a really special event. I agree with you two that it's not. I don't like the fact that they're putting the championship on the line. It made sense in 1992 when the championship was vacated. That's how Ric Flair won. Doesn't make sense in 2016. But that being said, I've got to, I think that there's going to be some surprises. I don't think it's going to be AJ Styles. I think that Finn Balor will go out there as a one-off. I'm hoping that Sami Zayn goes out there, maybe potentially doing something with Kevin Owens, either during the Rumble match or during the IC title match, because he's better. I can see them bringing in guys like Tommy Dreamer, but obviously they just had Tommy Dreamer out there. In the past they've had Booker T come back. They've had DDP come back. Last year, one of the surprises was Bubba Ray Dudley. So, you know, maybe they can spend a little money and get somebody like a Jeff Hardy out there. Even though he's in TNA, I don't know what his agreement with them is, if it's per show or if it's a contract. So, but I can see them bringing in an Attitude Era guy to be in the Rumble itself. I'm gonna, I hate to say it, but I think that they're gonna push Reigns even further up. So I think that it's going to be Roman Reigns walking away as the champion and as the Royal Rumble winner. And I hate to say that. So, but that's what it is. You guys have any other thoughts about Royal Rumble?
I got my predictions.
Somebody other than Reigns.
I think you are. But let's hear from Killer Kev. What are your thoughts?
I've got a surprise entrance for the Royal Rumble. He's going to be number 30. And here's the guy who's going to do it. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
The leader of Goldman Sachs is a billionaire who comes to Congress and tells us we should cut Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. Secretary Clinton, I'll just point the finger at you. You've received over $600,000 in speaking fees from Goldman Sachs in 1 year. I find it very strange that a major financial institution that pays $5 billion in fines for breaking the law, not one of their executives is prosecuted, while kids who smoke marijuana get a jail sentence.
Time, Andrea.
Well, that's right. It's going to be not only the next WWE World Heavyweight Champion, but your next president, Bernie Sanders.
Are they all going to feel the burn out there?
They're going to feel the burn.
That's why we keep you around, Killer Kev.
And since speaking of feeling the burn, also wanted to mention this as well. Actually, as I do that, we're going to add in Kenny Starmaker Bolin right now, but we're going to make this announcement here real quick. There is still time for listeners of the Undisputed Wrestling Show and Angry Marks Podcast Network to get enrolled in our annual Royal Rumble pool. That drawing will be happening this Thursday night live on Thursday night AMP, 9 p.m. right here at angrymarks.com. We are going to be holding our annual drawing. What you do to get in on our contest, get on Twitter, send a message to Angry Marks, at Angry Marks, with the hashtag Rumble Pool. We will put your name into a drawing. We've got 30 balls lined up in the old bingo dispenser, and we're going to roll them out one by one, and we're gonna pull your name, then we're going to draw the number, and whatever number you get, that's going to be your number in the Royal Rumble, and whoever that wrestler is, that's going to be your guy. So if you draw number one, we already know Roman Reigns is going to be your guy. But, you know, if we draw number 30, whoever number 30 is, that's the guy you're wanting to win. And the winner is going to get an exclusive DVD set courtesy of AngryMarks.com. We got plenty of spots still open, so come sign up. Come get them.
Excellent. All right. Do we have the star maker, Kenny Bolin, on here?
Well, can you hear me? And if you say yes, then you do.
We do hear you. I'm the Bearded Wonder, Zane Paisley. We've got my friend Rich Abbott on with us. We've got four against one on you tonight because you
were
such a big of a guest.
Whoa, wait a minute. Four of you great minds against me? You better go get four more.
We've got Drew Skills, and we have...
Nah, that's just kidding. You need six more. Who the fuck am I kidding?
We have the Morning Star, Will Huckabee, on. First off, Kenny, thanks so much for coming on with us. Really looking forward to talking with you.
Well, I had totally forgotten that I was supposed to do this show tonight, and I just walked back in from having dinner with my son and helping them get a new apartment tonight. So glad somebody reminded me, is all I can tell you.
Did you go to Golden Corral?
Well, hell, where do you think I went? It's King Eats Free there. Of course I went to Golden Corral. Now, tomorrow night, we'll be going to Pozzoli's. The night after that, we'll be going to O'Charley's. Night after that, we'll be at Hooters. Night after that, we'll be at a place called Rooster's, some of the best chicken you ever had. Followed up by Raising Cane's, another great chicken place here in Louisville. And then we'll probably recycle and start all over again. Maybe. Well, you know what? I am having dinner Thursday, lunch rather, with Jimmy Cornette. We're going to try and hash out some differences, and I'll be having dinner with Jimmy Cornette at a place here called Chili's, if we don't cancel that and go to Home Run Burger.
Now, are you going to be bringing Jim's illegitimate son with him?
Jim's illegitimate son is in the hospital right now. He's got pneumonia. He's clinging to life as we speak. I was going to treat him to Golden Corral tonight, but he's under the weather pretty bad and got pneumonia. I got him a special little job down there at UPS. so he can be somewhat self-sufficient. He's got Jimmy's genes, so the poor kid ain't got much of a shot as it is anyway, but we're doing everything we can for him.
That's very kind of you to take care
of that. Well, it's, you know, common decencies in some people, but not Jimmy Cornette.
That's true. That's true. I'm going to kick it over to
quit hogging the whole damn show. You got 19 people there. Let somebody else talk.
I'm gonna kick it over to a big fan, Drew Skills. Drew, what do you have for Kenny Bolin?
We'll see if he's a big fan or not. We'll see what he knows about me.
Well, Kenny, I'm glad you're on. The only reason that you are on so we can boost our ratings, just like that Jimmy Cornette does. He brings you on to bring in the listeners, and that's why we're doing it as well.
At least you guys admit it. That's more than you can get Cornette to do and CNN or whatever the hell his name is, whatever they call him down there.
TSOB, I think it is. But
MFSB by TSOP. You got, at least you listen to the show. I know you've been listening.
I do listen. It is hilarious. The back and forth with you two is the highlight of my podcast listening to when you're on the show. So I appreciate you coming on tonight. And tell us a little bit that dynamic between you and Jimmy. You guys go back quite a bit, don't you?
Probably goes back to late 1975, I guess. Maybe even as early as late 74 when I started going to the Louisville Gardens. And I was the only fan that Jerry Lawler had. There'd be 5,000 people in the Louisville Gardens, and the only person in the entire building rooting for Jerry Lawler was me. And they would throw shit at me. And of course, they'd never hit me. They'd hit all the fans around me. The crooked arm some bitches couldn't throw. And one day, Cornette, he was down there taking pictures and everything. And during intermission, I went down and got a little closer to ringside because I used to buy the cheap gin. I've been battling a cough here, guys. And if I hit the cough button every time I cough, you'll never hear me. So I was wandering around during intermission. I would leave my general admission seat. What I did is I got the front row of general admission, which was a $2.50 ticket. That kept me from buying the $4 ticket that was one row in front of me. And Lord knows I couldn't afford the $6.50 ringside seats that Jimmy and his mother sat in. So that was my way of having my weekly fun at the Louisville Gardens. Well, Jimmy saw me one day and he's waved me over. He says, man, he says, you're actually a true, you're a fan of Jerry Lawler. I said, yeah. I said, he's the only reason I come here. I said, I love Jerry Lawler matches. He says, man, they're going to kill you in here one day. He says, I need to get you where it's safe. He says, I take pictures all night. He says, my mother sits over there by herself. Why don't I introduce you to my mother? And why don't you take my seat? That way you'll be in the front row. You'll be safe. There's lots of security down here. He says, I think these fans are going to fucking kill you one night if we don't get you down here with us. He said, I've told my mother about you. The day there's this guy that sits in the general admission rooting for Jerry Lawler. And I'm worried about him. I think that was the first time I'd really ever met Jimmy. Excuse me, guys. This cough is just part of what we're going to have to deal with tonight, I guess. And so I started sitting in the front row with Jimmy's mother, and that's how our friendship started. And then he started coming out to LaGrange to see me, and I would go on odd weekends and visit him at his place in Middletown. And we've been the closest of dearest friends probably ever since, until he got into the wrestling business. And then he forgot about his old buddy, where he told me, Kenny, I'm just paving the way for us. Give me 6 months, and I'll have you in with me, and we will dominate wrestling. I'm going to be a manager. Kenny, I want you to be a wrestler. You know every move Jerry Lawler's ever made. We are going to own this business. And then a year went by, still no call up for Kenny. Then 2 years went by, then three, then five. And then 7 years later, I still wasn't in the business. Not knowing a clue as to why. And I ran into Nick Gulas on an accident. Really, I was in Nashville, Tennessee, working for a sales company down there as their sales manager. And ran into Nick Gulas. I was at Service Merchandise doing an exchange. And I introduced myself to him. He told me that he was starting a new wrestling company affiliated with the NWA. And I told him that I was very good friends with Jerry Lawler and Jim Cornette. And he says, you're not in the business? I said, not yet. I said, I've been aspiring to be. He said, well, I got news for you, son. He said, I'm going to make you the next Jerry Lawler. I said, well, I said, I've given it some thought. And I said, I don't really think I want to be a wrestler, not especially not full time. I said, I think my talents lie more in probably management and television commentary. That's what I would like to do. I said, now, if you still have an interest in me, I said, I'd be very interested in being a part of your company. So we agreed to that, and then I started working for Nick Gulas in Nashville with not really much support or help from Jerry Lawler or Jimmy Cornette at all. And that's how tough it was to get in the business back then, is that 7 years, two of my best friends were two of the biggest stars in the business, knowing I had the talent to do this, and I still couldn't get in. And they claimed their reason was, is because in amateur wrestling, I was 212-0 at Oldham County. Whenever we had our bullshit matches we did called the KWA, where Jimmy made belts and all this shit, well, I wasn't putting nobody over. They were going to be real matches. And if you were going to win, even though I was wearing Jerry Lawler's tights that he gave me, if you were going to win, you were going to beat me. Well, nobody could beat me. I was a pretty tough little SOB back in my day. I knew all the wrestling moves, and plus a few that I'd made up on my own. And I was very difficult to beat. So every time Jimmy made new belts, I'd beat him and take them from him. So I had all the belts before it was over with. And so they said, we don't think Kenny will put anybody over. Kenny won't play ball. That's what Jimmy told everybody. Jerry didn't know for sure one way or the other. This was all Jimmy shit. But Jimmy's excuse was, Kenny won't put nobody over. He won't play ball. He doesn't understand how professional wrestling works, and I don't think we should put Kenny in pro wrestling. It's not for him. And so when I found out Jimmy was telling people this, I pulled him aside one day at the airport when I'd normally meet him at the airport and we'd go to dinner. I said, hey, cocksucker. I said, I don't need you running around telling everybody I wasn't made for the wrestling business because I wouldn't put people over. I said, I didn't put people over into bullshit that we did for free. I said, if you're paying me $100,000 a year, $200,000, $400,000, I'll do any goddamn thing you want. I said, I know the difference between doing a job and doing a job. I said, so quit telling people that. I said, you're fucking up my chances. So that was really the only heated word we ever had about that situation. And plus, I wasn't too hot that it took him 7 years to have the guts to tell me that was what he thought the reason was. But what the actual reason was, do y'all remember when he fell off that scaffold?
Mm-hmm. For sure.
And Big Bubba Rogers, he blamed Big Bubba, said Big Bubba was supposed to catch him. Well, number one, my big fat ass wouldn't have fell off no scaffold and put somebody in position to have to catch me. He did that on his own. That was the risk he took. He wanted to be in a semi-main with the Road Warriors or whatever that match was. I was there that night. I was sitting in the cheap seats. Back then, it was probably difficult, even if you were his friend, to get a good seat for Starcade. So me and Missy Hyatt and a few other of Jimmy's friends were sitting along with my wife, my pregnant wife at the time, with my son Chris. Little did we know what a love he would have for the business and how good that he would be at it and how smart he was at it. And that was the night we also found out that his jealousy was what kept me out of the business. And this is all not bullshit, guys. I know some people think that me and Jimmy do a lot of this for entertainment. If they happen to be entertained, so be it. The truth is sometimes more entertaining than anything that a writer can write. And that night I went to him in the locker room after it was all over, and I said, Jimmy, I said, you are fucked up. Your knees are fucked. You can't even get to your car. I said, this is the time. I said, you know I can do it. Let me step in because you're going to be out a while. You're probably going to be out 6 weeks to 12 weeks. You might be lucky to be back then. Let me step in. Let me manage Dennis and Bobby. And I said, and whatever happens between that time, when you come back, old Kenny's not going to be so reluctant to hand over the reins. And we have a built-in storyline that will be fucking incredible about how you came back and you didn't have a team waiting on you. Or you do get your team. I said, we can go several different ways with this. You come back, you do get your team, and I'm not too happy about giving up the reins and persistently fuck with you, get my own team, whatever. I said, we can do it any way that you want. We've got a built-in storyline that people will fucking eat up. Oh, no, we're not going to do that. No, you're not going to manage them, and I'll tell you why. I said, why is that? He says, because if I let you in this business, and if I let you manage Bobby and Dennis, I will not have a job when I get back. So he kind of paid me a compliment because he basically told me that I was better than him to begin with. But on the other hand, didn't trust me to play ball with him. Then I forced him out of the business. Because me and Jimmy feuding with each other is worth far more money. We're better against each other than we are without each other. Have you listened to Jimmy's podcast without me? Do you want to tell me those things are listenable? I'm telling you this as a 100% shoot. Where he thinks that people give a shit about his trees and his political views and his Muslim views. And his, I guess y'all heard about that shit. His Muslim, sure. His views on Republicans and Democrats and people that believe in God and people that don't. Why does he think that we can, and I can understand one show dedicated to that, but every fucking show, every one 50 minutes of shoving it down people's throats? And that's why that is 6 out of 7, and I haven't got the ratings back on last week's show, but I think I'm safe to say that 7 of the highest 8 rated shows he's done are me. You know who the only one is to beat me? Stone Cold Steve Austin. All right, I'll take that. The biggest name in the business beat me in the ratings. I'll take that. And I'll be honest with you. I hear he beat me by about 10,000 downloads. Well, fuck, he's the biggest name in the business. I'm a local guy. I never had any national television to speak of. Really, all I ever had was my exposure at OVW and what I developed on nine seasons now of Bowling Alley. And it just happened to become a pretty popular show.
And, of course, all the stars that you made while you were at OVW.
Well, and I didn't even bring those up, did I? Now, here you go if you want to talk about who the best manager was. And I want to debate Jimmy so bad on this I can't see straight. But this is a simple and easy debate because you can handle it right here. How many big stars did Jimmy manage that are currently a big star in the business today? I'll sit back and I'll wait for you to name all of them. You're all done. There's 19 of you there and you can't name a goddamn one. Can't name one. All right. Now, and we'll see how much you all know about me. How many people did I manage or feud with? Because I count feuding as well, because the way that you got called up in OVW, you were either with me or you were against me. Those that were with me were the Mark Henrys, The Miz, Damian Sandow, John Cena, titled to drop that name. Rico Constantino, he was Prototype back then. Sylvester Turkey, Bull Buchanan, Sean O'Hare, God rest his soul. And that's just to name a few. Those that feuded against me to get called up. Randy Orton, Brock Lesnar, Shelton Benjamin, Nova, who went on to become Simon Dean. And that's just to name a few. There were many, many more. And they finally calculated that I managed 54 wrestlers in 10 years that got a shot in the WWE, that at least got a shot, at least got a paycheck from the WWE. And the ones that I feuded with, I think, even exceeded that. So I probably touched the careers of about 100 wrestlers. And people found out in a hurry that if you wanted to get, and I'm not trying to blow my own horn or sound like the greatest damn thing since sliced bread, but that was the God's honest truth. If you wanted called up, you better be involved in a program with Bowling Services. Because if you weren't, because Sin was the manager there, Jimmy's wife, you want to know how many people? She managed to get called up to the WWE?
Just Leviathan.
I get ready to say, I'll sit back and wait for that list for you. It was called Leviathan. Well, there's a better known as Batista. Well, she can fucking have that deal, because boy, didn't he make a real impact on the business. He can shove that one.
I tell you, Kenny, I broke in with Les Thatcher at HW, and we used to do our
whole. Les is a dear friend of mine. Now make sure you tell him hello for me.
I definitely would do. You will remember tapings down there, guys, before you guys taped.
You all did the HWA tapings and on what Sunday nights, wasn't it? Didn't y'all do Sunday nights?
Yes, sir. And your angle, the Kenny Bowen angle, was definitely, you know, the top of what was going on at that time.
Well, you were down around there and saw it, and that was back when we were in that tiny little building over there in Jeffersonville. We had no business being affiliated with the WWE, but yet we were. And then, of course, we went on to the building that they helped us get into and that Danny Davis is still in over there to this day. And no, Danny Davis didn't sell fucking OVW. First Murphy calls in and says, did he really sell OVW? Shut the fuck up. Danny's there every goddamn week. I ain't there.
I'll tell you, Kenny, you talk about Jimmy putting you over and that foreword that he put in your book. It was a tearjerker.
Wasn't that nice of him to? And you know what? He claims he didn't do it. You've seen my writing. My writing sucks. I'm no writer. And for him to even accuse me of having anything to do with that foreword really pisses me off because you've seen how the book's written. I am no Rhodes Scholar when it comes to writing. A lot of people say, well, I forgot more about wrestling than he ever knew. Well, I forgot more about English than most people knew, and it's apparent in my book because I don't have a fucking clue. I tell the stories. I had another guy write it for me, and John Cosper, who's written several sci-fi novels. He also wrote Bluegrass Brawlers, which me and Jimmy Cornette are heavily involved in that because, hell, I was heavily involved in wrestling here in Louisville for 20 years. Longer than Jerry Lawler, if you get right down to it, because Jerry went away. Jerry and our whole crew went away. I was here for 20 straight years. And it was a different era back then. And then I'm a little jealous of the era that Jerry Lawler and Coco Beware and The Undertaker and all those guys that were great in Memphis that went on to the WWE. I'm jealous of what they had because I pointed this out to Jimmy and even my son. Is that the lowest guy on the totem pole on Memphis wrestling was a huge television star. Back before Coco Ware was a big deal, if Coco Ware was walking down the street, people would freak. Oh my God, that's Coco Beware. Yeah, he's on Memphis wrestling. He's on TV every week. And then even go lower than that, the Radford Tindalls, the Sonny, well, not Sonny King, but I can't think of his name. So something King was his last, wasn't Derek King, because I know Derek very well. King Cobra, that was his name. And these were job guys on Memphis television that were, if they saw him walking down the street, they assumed they was making $150,000 a year. They didn't realize they were working for $50 a television taping and whatever they could get at a house show. A lot of those guys were probably lucky to be making $250 to $300 a week, even when the territory was at its highest. Because Nick Goulas was one of the worst payers of all time. People could not believe that I was actually getting $75 a show out of him as a so-called rookie. I never viewed myself as a rookie because I was trained and developed by everybody that went on to become a big star. I learned everything I learned in wrestling from Jerry Lawler, from the handsome Jimmy Valiant to the Jackie Fargos to Jerry Jarrett. And people said, well, did you learn anything from Cornette? I taught Cornette every motherfucking thing he knows.
That's evident.
The fact that you could accuse me of learning anything from Jimmy Cornette, and the only thing that I never taught him that he had naturally was being an irritating, cocksucking prick that people would hate because he was served with a silver spoon by his mother. His father was a big deal with the Courier Journal and the Louisville Times, which is a defunct paper now, which is another thing a Cornette touched that went out of business. He was a spoilt little brat, which that was the persona that he brought to television. Now, I didn't teach him that because I didn't know it. I lived practically in poverty when I was a kid. My mother was on food stamps. My father was the last person ever arrested in the state of Kentucky for cattle rustling. He was with a guy that stole a cow. And was the last man documented ever to be the notorious Johnny Boland. God rest his soul. He just died here recently. And he stole a cow so he could feed his family for the winter. I had it cut up in about 400 pounds of meat. We had hamburgers and steaks. And, well, while we were eating high and hog, he was serving 8 years in a penitentiary for stealing a goddamn cow. Now, of course, if you'd done that on the Gunsmoke, Matt Dillon would fire a couple of rounds at you and you'd hang. So I guess it could have been worse. They didn't hang Johnny Boland, but he got 8 years in the penitentiary. And to tell the truth, to tell the story totally honestly, he did get out in 8 months for good behavior. A lot of people think he served the full 8 years. No, he didn't, but he did serve 8 months, and that's a long time for stealing a cow. It's an even longer time for being with the guy that stole a cow. He's not even the guy that stole the cow. He was with the guy that stole the cow and got 8 months. But so I don't think me and Cornette, you know, sometimes we get compared together so much because we've been friends for so long and tolerate each other for so long. We are about as polar opposite as you can get. We have so many different views. I love current music. He hates current music. He won't listen to anything that AC/DC didn't record. Anything past that, he ain't going to listen to it. But I did my comparison for you. How many wrestlers do I still have that are performing today and making big money and impacts in the business? It was quite a few, right? I didn't get an exact number. But you would agree with quite a few? And how many does Cornette have?
I think we're still waiting on that number. We're
still waiting on that number, which tells me that Cornette was a coattail rider. Everybody that Jimmy ever managed, everybody he ever managed was already a star or had been as big a star as they were going to become. Who did he elevate? Now, I will give you, he may have elevated Dennis and Bobby to somewhat, a little bit, because they were Hickerson and Condry at one time, and they were big impacts here in the Memphis area, Memphis and Louisville wrestling. Bobby Eaton and Duke Myers and Coco Beware had also formed tag teams here that did pretty well. But I'll give you the Midnight Express did more than they did. But after the Midnight Express, who did he elevate? Yokozuna, the Mulkeys, the new Midnight Express, that was a big fucking hit. So you can't name them. And I want to have this debate with Jimmy so bad, and he don't want nothing to do with it because he knows I'm going to go down that road he don't want me to go down. You know what road that is? Let's analyze Jimmy's career. Let's analyze everything that he's touched. Well, he started out in Memphis wrestling. Memphis wrestling around anymore, boys? And I'm going to let you out. Nope. Well, he went from Memphis. He went to, let me get this right because I helped him move there. He went to the Superdome. And who was running that territory? That's Bill Watts, right?
Yep.
Yeah, are they still in business? Uh-uh.
No.
They're gone. He went from there. He went to the Von Erichs. Are they still in business?
They're gone.
No, they're gone. He went from there. He went to one of those women's divisions like GLOW. I don't think it was GLOW, but it was a women's wrestling. Are they still in business? No. No, they're gone. Well, he went from there and he went to WCW. Well, that's a big fucking company. Not even Jimmy Cornette can close them down. Well, are they still in business? No, they're gone. They're gone. Well, he went from there and he said, well, fuck, I've put that company to shame. I'm going to go to Smoky Mountain Wrestling and start my own company. Well, that was a huge fucking success. Where are they at now? They're gone.
Network they're now. Gone.
Well, he went from there and he went to the WWE. Well, they're not dead yet, but they've got their lowest ratings in the history of red. I'm not going to blame that one on Cornette. I know people think I'm going to. But they are now at their lowest ratings ever. The only company that Jimmy couldn't shut down, and that was because they got rid of him and shipped his ass down here to form a developmental company because they couldn't fucking stand him up there, but they couldn't get out of his contract. So he agreed, well, I'll go home to Louisville, and I'm going to play ball with my old buddy Kenny Boland, who's been down there in OVW for a couple of years now, and I'm going to go down there and play ball with him. And what did he do? The day he showed up, he had me fired from the broadcast booth. Why? Why? So he could put his egotistical ass on television and be the commentator. So here we had a nice mix with me and Dean Hill. Dean Hill is the babyface commentator. Me is the heel. That is what prospective fans want these days. They don't want two fucking baby faces on the microphone. They want a heel and they want a baby face. Me and Dean Hill had that totally covered. He couldn't see that. He couldn't see that that was where the business was and sit in the back and be a promoter like Jerry Jarrett or like Vince McMahon or whomever, even though Vince was a very damn good commentator. I will give him that. Jimmy needed to keep his ass in the back. And if I had a week I didn't want to be on television or needed to be out of town or wanted to focus more on managing, Jimmy could haul his ass out of the back and commentate then. But no, he had to fire me. He had to get rid of me. He didn't want me at the commentator's booth. And he said, as a matter of fact, the only way you're going to be involved in OVW is to get your own wrestlers, sign them to their own contracts, and compete with our guys. If you do that, you can be on the show. Otherwise, hightail it, you're done. Well, that's a fine fucking friend for you, isn't it? That's a fine friend. So what did I do? I went out, and the first person I signed was somebody else he fired. Jack Black, I made him head of security. A big man to watch my back and to let me get shit done. After that, I signed Bull Buchanan. WWE had kind of let him go. They sent him down here. I said, hey, if you don't want to sign with them, sign with me. You sign with me, I'm going to get you back into WWE. And he wasn't sure that I could do that. I said, let me prove it. Give me 90 days. Well, with a little over 90 days, we had Bull Buchanan back in the WWE. And then I got Mark Henry. And then I got Rico Constantine. No, I got Rico later. Then I got, who was it? I did get Rico first. And then Rico helped me get John Cena. Rico laid the groundwork to get that done. And then, of course, that led to Sylvester Turkey, Lance Cade, Jindrak, good God, just so damn many. I can't think of them all. I'm old and got no memory, but I'm sure it's documented somewhere. You can look it up on Wikipedia. It'll tell you who all I had.
The list goes on and on, Kane. I tell you,
I've talked so much to the 19 of you that are there. I've hardly got to say a goddamn word. I'm going to shut up.
Well, we would love to facilitate that debate for you. So anytime you can talk Jimmy into coming on.
We're looking for a moderator. Maybe you can motivate his cowardly ass to come down here, because I'll slaughter him. It ain't going to be like the first one where, well, you know, we're going to have to kiss Jimmy's ass a little bit. We're going to have to go easy on him. If we slaughter him in this, he'll never play ball with us anymore. So I admit I went a little easy on him, and I threw him a few softballs. Well, there ain't going to be no softballs on the next debate. I'm going to point out facts, and as you guys know, if anybody wants to argue these facts with me, I'm sitting right here. We don't have to wait for Jimmy. If somebody wants to take Jimmy's side and defend him, let me know. The only thing he had on me is he had two monumental national television companies behind him, and he still couldn't put together better talent than I did. I took my talent from dirt. No one had ever heard of any of my guys before, maybe short of Bull Buchanan and possibly Mark Henry. Other than that, people had never heard of, they'd never heard of the prototype. They'd never heard of Rico Constantino, other than being on American Gladiators. They barely knew anything about Sean O'Hare, Mark Jindrak, Lance Cade. These guys were The Miz, fucking reality star, yeah. Rene Dupree, I forgot about Rene. Rene should have been a bigger star than he was, but he had some issues. We won't go into those. And he knows what they are. I think he's still dealing with them. But
well, Jimmy's been on the show before, Kenny. He's been on before, and you know we'd love to have him back. And
who's been on the show? I missed the name.
Jimmy. Jimmy's been on the show before.
Oh, has he? Has he?
He has been on the show before, but I'm sure he's going to.
Did he tell you what a great manager I was while he was on?
I know that. Host him, Zane.
That I know Killer Kev had mentioned you, and he kind of brushed you off. So,
oh fuck him!
Yeah.
That tells you what a piece of shit he is. That tells you right there.
We'd probably try to have MSOP moderate for us, but we'd love to do it.
No, we don't need MSP moderating shit, because who the hell's ever heard of MSP? He ain't got no respect. Nobody likes him. He's already hated. He's already hated as Alice Ratley is. They ran Ratley off. She's hiding in a damn. She killed every account she had. And TSOP, MFSB, CNN, GNN, TBS, whatever the hell he wants to call him, calls himself by fucking initials. Like I told him on last week's show, my fucking name's Kenny. What's your name? And he garbled off a bunch of shit I couldn't understand. And I said, just fucking go by MSL or whatever the fuck you call yourself.
Let me ask you a question, Kenny. Is Court Bauer now following you? Did we get that settled?
No, he ain't following me. He's scared. He don't want none, because he realizes that all the fans love me more. They know me. Google me and Google Court Bauer and tell me what you come up with. Court Bauer is apparently some rich fuck that bought his way into the wrestling business. Basically a glorified Cornette. That's how Cornette got in. If his family didn't have money, he wouldn't be in the wrestling business. Jerry Jarrett hated him. The only reason Jerry Jarrett hired him is because little teeny, that they called her, Jerry Jarrett's mother, loved Jimmy for some fucking reason. I don't know why. Well, probably because she loved Jimmy's mother. Jimmy's mother was a saint for putting up with Jimmy Cornette for all those years. You talk about somebody that should have been done away at birth, somebody that should have had a coat hanger nearby and just put an end to him once and forever. But she went ahead and gave birth to that little fucker anyway, and that's the appreciation he showed. So, no, I mean, yeah, we've been friends, but he's fucked me over so many times. How many times can you ignore that? Even my son says, Dad, it's amazing you're not in a penitentiary somewhere. How you have not just decided to kill that motherfucker is beyond me. Even my son hates him, and he's his godson. He hates Jimmy.
Well, that's a pretty bad deal. He left you guys stranded there, you and Dennison, with that limo.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Left us stranded. The limo, let's face it, that limo needed some help. And I was trying to help my brother out. I got a good deal on it. And I thought it had been totally refurbished, but there was still some work to be done. Did y'all ever see any pictures of that limo?
I didn't get to see the pictures.
I don't think we allowed any pictures to be taken, to be honest with you. That was a sad looking limo, to be honest with you. But we was trying to help my brother out. But no, Jimmy, yep. Once again, being a prima donna there, we all were together in a fully functioning good limo. I mean, it beauty-wise, it lacked in some things. But overall, it was a good limo. It got us to Jackson, Tennessee, and almost all the way back. And then it ran out of gas about a mile from my house, strategically. So Jimmy, who could have come back and checked on us, and took care of us, maybe took us all out for breakfast or something. Big rich motherfucker. But no, he got in his vehicle and he left, laughing hysterically all the way home, from what I was told. My son said he was laughing in hysterics because he knew he was going to get in his vehicle and go home, and he had no clue if I was going to make it home or not. Fortunately, someone brought my Cadillac back to me, and then I went and got him some gas. We had to force the station to open 45 minutes early because they weren't going to open. We explained to them, hey, we got some important people in a limo here that need some help. So, yeah, that night was a fucking disaster. And, oh, Jimmy, not an ounce of sorrow in his blood. He still tells me to this day, no, I had no intentions of going back. I wasn't going to check on you guys. Fuck y'all. I was taking care of number one. And the same way he is with his finances and his money, you know, he's all pissed off because he's vested heavily in the oil industry. And when gas is $5 a gallon, Jimmy Cornette makes a shitload of motherfucking money. And I know that for a fact because I hear him brag about it all the time. So what does he do now that gas for me and you and the common man is down? Here in Louisville today, I've seen it as low as $1.59 a gallon. $1.59. I didn't see $1.59 a gallon when I was a teenager. I'm 50. I'll be 56 years old in March, and I'd never seen $1.59 a gallon. Well, I did. Actually, when I was a teenager, it was about 77 cents a gallon. I'm not convinced we're not going to get there. There was a place on TV the other day that was having gas wars, and they were selling gas for 47 cents a gallon. Well, that helps me, helps you, helps the 19 of you there that are hosting this show. We all benefit from it before Jimmy loses money. Jimmy, if I had to guess, I would say he's lost about $150,000 in the stock market due to the oil prices. So
on Facebook today.
Fuck the rest of us who can actually afford to go somewhere now. We can get in our vehicle and go visit Aunt Blabby down in Atlanta, or make it over to Philadelphia and visit the Corluza family or something. But no, Jimmy, fuck that. No, look at what I've lost. He is a self-righteous prick. And I wish people knew more of that than will admit. It's starting to come out because I'm the only one that tells the truth about him. And I think a lot of people thought that this was all the work. This was all a bunch of shit, all a little playtime. Bullshit. I'm telling 100% of the truth on Jimmy Cornette, and I dare him to fucking tell the truth on me. Because all he can do is make you feel sorry for me, knowing the background I came from, and that I was still able to be a success in the wrestling business, and still put together a pretty nice little company in Beats by Bolin, and still got hotter girlfriends than he'll ever have. You ever seen that ugly bitch he married? Good God. Tried to stick her tongue down my throat the day they got married. I'd do him a favor, show up there and be the best man, and that horny little bitch basically wrapped her thighs around me and tried to stick her tongue down my throat. Stacy Cornette, that's her real name, send my ass. Her name's Stacy, and she's a horny little leech. She leached onto Cornette because all the money he's got. That's the only reason she's with him. And today she milks him dry, I'm sure she'll be after somebody else in the WWE. That is the
well.
I can make up some things. Oh, Stacy's nice. She's a good cook. She makes an hell of an apple pie. Well, she does. But the other part's true too. Bitch.
She probably does a little bit of bodyguarding for him too.
No, y'all got with me. I thought this was going to be a nice little easy conversation here tonight, but y'all got me riled up the minute I had to hear the name Jimmy Cornette.
Hey, Kenny?
Yes.
Can I get you riled up a little more?
Go right ahead.
Well, I got a question for you. I don't know if there's any truth behind it, but I heard that you might have been...
Well, I'll tell you if there's any truth behind it.
I heard that you might have been the brainchild of the Montreal Screwjob.
Well, you know, where you heard it from was me. I was the one that toted on Bill After's show, so of course it's... that was when I really totally come clean with it, because I begged Jimmy, and I wasn't the brainchild, but I did have an awful lot to do with it with Jimmy, and we went back and forth on this for 3 weeks about how we were going to make sure that Bret Hart did not take the title to WCW with him, because the groundwork was already being laid to have WWE as a developmental company for Ohio Valley Wrestling. It was going to be another company, but they fucked up, did some stupid shit we asked them not to do. So we said, all right, you're stupid fucks. You can't follow simple instructions. So we're going to give this to OVW and Danny Davis. We liked him better anyway, but the other place at that time had better facilities than what OVW had. So we finally said, fuck it. We will get the better facilities in time. And so that's how the developmental deal ended up at Ohio Valley Wrestling, because it was going to go somewhere else, and they fucked that up. So I had a vested interest in WWE coming out looking good on this, because we already had the female wrestler. I'm blanking out on her name, the one that threw the belt in the trash. What was her name?
Medusa.
She had already gone and thrown her title belt in the garbage, and I knew Bret Hart was going to do exactly the same thing. That was exactly the kind of stuff that I expected Bischoff might try. And I don't blame him. Bury the other company as deep as you could. They had the foot on the WWE's throat, but lacked the ability to be able to just cut the circulation off altogether. They never did put the kill on them. And what killed WCW, and I don't know if anybody will admit this or even remembers, but do you remember when the NBA playoffs took WCW off television for about 3 or 4 weeks. Mm-hmm. And they were coming on very late at night. They were coming on very late at night, and Raw was coming on at 8 o'clock with no competition. And I'd always thought, you know, I'd watched both shows, and I always thought that Raw was way better than WCW. I said, but people are so hooked up in this invasion shit. And Hulk Hogan and Scott Hall and all the invasion crap, that they're not even going to give Raw a chance and realize it's a better show. Well, they had no choice. Excuse me. They had no choice when the playoffs hit, because now with the playoffs on, there's going to be 3 or 4 weeks that Raw is going to go on unopposed. And that was when the streak ended. That was when the fans said, uh-oh, this is pretty good shit over here on Monday Night Raw. And WCW tanked in the ratings from that point on. It got lower to the point of no return. But the NBA playoffs are what killed them. If that had never happened, who knows how much longer that streak would have continued? Because people weren't given Raw a chance. They were going to where they were conditioned to go. And that was watch TNT and Hulk Hogan and Scott Hall. And who's the other? Kevin Nash. No, they weren't going there to see Horace Hogan. I can promise you that. They weren't going there to see X-Pac. And I am the one that invented the term X-Pac heat.
You did.
I am the one. If there's somebody that did it before me, I'd sure like to meet them. I'd like to know who the person is, because I hated that little fucker with a passion. He tried to buy. He tried to buy drugs for me when he was the 1-2-3 kid. When he found out that I was not only in the wrestling business, but I also worked for Humana. Well, Humana was a big hospital chain here at that time, but I was in the insurance and physician and nurse recruitment division. I had no access to drugs. Well, he didn't know that. So he claims he doesn't know who I am. He claims this meeting never happened. He's a lying cocksucker. He'd come up to me in the back of the Louisville Gardens after someone told him who I was. He's Cornette's friend, and he's a big shot with Humana. Well, he heard Humana and immediately thought that I had access to pain pills, and that was not the case. So he can claim what he wants. Like I said, I don't lie. I don't bullshit. I got nobody to answer to. Nobody's trying to hire me. I'm not going to be on Raw next week. And if I piss somebody off, oh, they're not going to hire Kenny Bowman. I retired 3.5 years ago with no intention of ever working for another wrestling company again. I do my own shit. I do my own shows. If I'm asked nicely, I do other people's shows. But I do not lie. I tell the truth. I might fuck around and play with you a little bit, but I do not lie. If I tell you something for truth, that's what it is. And I normally have witnesses who can verify it, which I have probably 20 witnesses that saw him come to me trying to get drugs from me. So, whatever.
All right, Kenny, we've got to wrap up. Because
and in American terms, whatever means fuck you.
We've got to wrap up. Because
what do you mean you got to wrap up? You asked me to be on your show. You had me come on at 10:30. I get on 5 minutes late. I'm on a roll. I'm burying people left and right. I practically have a shovel down here full of dirt. And you want to wrap the show up?
We have to. We've got another spot.
Well, all right. I'm tired. My fucking throat's dry. I want something to drink. I don't give a fuck. Wrap it up.
But we would love to have you on again anytime.
Of course you would. Listen to how great this one's been. You'd be an idiot.
It has been. It's been amazing.
Probably the highest rated show of all fucking time.
Probably.
Well, y'all can let me know. Maybe Stone Cold Steve Austin. Wait a minute. You're wrapping me up for what? What was the reason you just gave me?
There's another podcast following us.
Oh, well, in that case, I thought you meant you had another guest. Well, bump them. They're going to suck.
No, you're the man.
All right. Well, as long as I was made, who was on before me?
We had Pitbull Gary Wolf on before you.
Well, he's actually a nice guy. I've met him a couple of times in the Philadelphia market, and I can't say anything bad about him. I wanted to, but he was a nice guy.
Hey, before we let you go, can you hit your plugs? Facebook, Star Maker Bowling.
I thought you'd never ask. I thought you was going to be like at fucking MSL and hang up on me before I could plug anything or anybody.
Twitter, you're at Star Maker Bowling. What else you got?
At Star Maker Bowling on Twitter, / Star Maker Bowling on Facebook. And that was really about the primary two that I use. I sell my book there. You know the title of my book. Tell them the title of my book.
Your book is called I Probably Screwed You Too. The Mostly True Stories of Kenny Starmaker Bowen.
How did we do this entire show and not even talk about my book? What the
you
fuck?
You did. Drew Skills brought it up because he's got it.
Oh, well, okay. All right. Maybe we did. I've been saying a lot of shit.
We talked about how great that foreword was. From Dennis.
That's right. You're right. I'm an idiot and I'm tired.
I think Dennison cleared that up, too. I think Dennison cleared that Dennison, up, but that Dennison, was from
Jimmy. Yeah, Dennison did clear it up, and especially after Jimmy left him stranded in his limo. He ain't both of our attorneys anymore. Let's put it that way. That ended. But yeah, if you want to get that book, you can either get it from me on Facebook. Just write my inbox. Autographed copies are $25. If you don't give a fuck about my autograph, fuck you. You can get it on Amazon for like $17 or $18. If you don't think my autograph's worth $7, hey, wait till I die. You'll find out otherwise. If you want my t-shirts, I've got the BS t-shirts, I've got the I Screwed You t-shirts, I've got the I'm a Bowling Guy t-shirts, the Beats by Bowling headphones, you can't forget those. We've now sold over 3,500 sets of Beats by Bowling headphones. We have the Beats by Bowling wireless buds, we have the Beats by Bowling pill, and we even have the Beats by Bowling GoView camera. So we got all kinds of shit we're selling. You know why? Because Kenny needs the fucking money, that's why. So reach me on Facebook. I'll make a deal with you. The more you buy, the better buy you get. Now, what more can you ask out of one man?
Well, as I said, we'd love to have you back on. Thank you so much for being on with us.
And thank you for all 19 of you there. I only heard like 12 of you, but I know there's 19 of you there. And certainly appreciate you having me on. And I'm sorry you ever had Cornette on your show. That only degrades any work you've done previously. But hopefully I've done something to get that shit stain off your sheets.
We appreciate that, sir.
Anything I can do to help.
All right, listeners. Kenny Starmaker Bowling at Starmaker Bowling.
Oh, when will this be posted? When can my fans tune into this? I will make sure to plug this on Facebook for my 5,000 fans there. No, I don't have 97 million followers on Twitter. I've got like 2,500. I'm not on Twitter that often. And I think a lot of these people that have a million followers is bullshit because I'm 10 times more famous than most of them. So at least you know the followers I got are real and they'll actually buy something from you.
Especially that damn Court Bauer.
Probably so. Probably so. Court Bauer. He's behind the whole fucking thing.
It'll probably get edited and wrapped up tomorrow afternoon. So we will definitely.
Well, one more thing before I go, Court Bauer, you better follow me, you son of a bitch, because I'll never do your show until you do. Realize who the ratings anchor is on your show, Court Bauer, or I'll never do your fucking show, and it's only hurting you. It don't hurt me. All right. I'm done with you.
Think that's the final word. Thanks so much for coming on.
Well, as I say on my show, I did say good day.
All right, guys. Super fun show tonight. Next week, we've got Randy the Pimp Taylor, and I'm super looking forward to the show. Gary
Michael. Oh, that'll be a ratings blast.
Well, but in our main event is Gary Michael. Gary Michael Capetta is going to be on, too.
Who?
Gary Michael Capetta from
Oh, Jesus Christ. You sure you guys don't want me to just come back next week and save y'all again? Jesus Christ. Good God.
Well, did you say you had a show?
That's like showing The Walking Dead, following that up with The Ghost and Mr. Chicken. Jesus.
Well, what about 2 weeks on our first show in February? We've got a wrestling author. He's worked with Stan Hansen and a lot of other people. Scott Teal.
All right. Well, that's better.
And from Harlem Heat, Stevie Ray is going to be on.
Well, there you go. Now you're talking. You got a show going there.
Okay, awesome. There you go.
So fuck next week's show. The show after that. Ain't nobody going to be listening to next week's show. A couple of burglars and Arthur Godfrey for crying out loud. No disrespect to whoever it is y'all just said.
We need to get that debate going with you and Cornette on our show here, and we'll moderate.
I'll debate him anywhere, anytime, any moderator. It don't matter. I will destroy him. And that ain't easily done when it comes to Cornette. But no matter what bullshit he makes up, he can't pull anything out of his ass that's going to make me look like a liar. I'll tell you that.
Killer Kevin, we got to make that happen.
And I'm real sorry about next week's show. I wish I had booked it for you.
All right, Kev, you ready?
Stevie Ray. I'm looking forward to hearing that one. I'll tune into that one myself.
Okay, we'll post that for you also.
And if Stevie starts tanking, I'll call in and save the show.
We appreciate that, sir.
You tell Stevie I'm right there. Just reach out and tag me if you need me, son.
Excellent.
Kenny Boland, the podcast saver. That's going to be my new moniker here coming up soon.
You need to get a podcast, Kenny. What are you waiting on? Why don't you have your own podcast?
I do have my own podcast. It's called The Bowling Alley, you stupid fuck. What the hell?
Why didn't you plug that?
I figured everybody in the goddamn free world knew about it. I didn't think I had to plug The Bowling Alley. Ninth goddamn season. We start season 10 in March. Hey, Kenny, why don't you get your own show? Just when I think y'all have done your homework. Just when I think you know something about me. Kenny, why don't you do your own show? I've been doing my own goddamn show for almost 10 fucking years. God damn, I got a good mind not to save Stevie Ray's show now. Y'all pissed me off.
Too busy talking to Cornette about Muslims.
Yeah, well. You got me steamed.
Where can our listeners hear the Bowling Alley?
You're going to fucking love this. BowlingAlley.com, goddammit. Boy, that just blew everybody away, didn't it? Where? Who would have thought? Oh, Jesus. I wish my own show was this good. Maybe you'd have heard of it.
We'll come on and save you on your show, Kenny, anytime you want.
I appreciate it. You'll come on, let me know about the show y'all don't know about. Just come on anytime.
Well, you used to be on our network. You used to be on Angry Mark.
I did, but a guy named Rob Dickin was running that. And well, we went our separate ways. Now I have a host out of London that runs the Bowling Alley. And we just figured it'd be a lot easier if we just had an address, and it's on iTunes and all that shit too, but the easy way is thebowlingalley.com. We don't do this drive-through bullshit that charge people money. All the shows are archived. You can listen to them all. And I thought we ended the show about 10 minutes ago. Well, we did until y'all insulted.
Yes. All right, Kev.
Give me the name of the guy that didn't know that I had the bowling alley. Give me the name.
Will Huckabee. Will Huckabee was his name.
You will not be on the Stevie Ray Show. I'll tell you that right now. I'll have it.